Welcome back. The race will begin in 1 minute and 2 seconds. But we are going to see happen is me driving the safety car. We will go one lap, I will enter the pits. When I enter the pit entry, the race will be free and the cars will accelerate, but there will be no overtaking until they have passed the start and finish line. So, while I drive the safety car, I will shut up and I will leave you to do the commentating to yourself. Good luck with that. I will be with you in a short moment again. Yep, as you can clearly tell, that was not the race. That was 1 minute and 15 seconds behind the safety car. Something has gone wrong. I'm sorry to tell you, I don't know what, and we're restarting the race. So we're trying once again. I will be driving the safety car once again. And we'll have another go at this. The rate we're coming behind schedule right now, that doesn't matter, to be honest. Still, 1 minute and 15 seconds until we do the start again. Somebody actually just left the server. Too bad, this is race session and the game won't allow you to rejoin. So, tough luck. Let's see if we can just see who's missing. That was Ben Jewell in the blue and orange Aston Martin. He's dropped out, he's not in the race anymore. Okay. 40 seconds until the light go green. I will drive the safety car again and we will have another go. That's it. That's the green flag. Henrik Hoyer is spearing off into the lead. Closely followed by Lars Granberg trying to attack him here on the first corner. I don't think that's going to happen. No, Lars backing off, which means he now has Nikolaj Pedersen very close on his tail. Also, actually, just behind Nikolaj Pedersen there, we see the first car in GT1, Kasper Hougaard, who's keeping up impressively well with the LMP1 cars, but he will be—he will no doubt be left behind in a couple of minutes. Behind Kasper Hougaard, we have Peter Munkholm in his Chrysler Viper. He's on second place. As expected, Henrik Hoyer has raced off into the lead. He's in first place, and he has a nice margin down to Lars Granberg of around 5.5 seconds already, actually. Between Lars and Nikolaj Pedersen, on the other hand, there's only 0.4 seconds. Still running closely, these two guys. Kasper Hougaard first in GT1. He's being chased by Peter Munkholm in the Chrysler Viper. They are divided by 1.5 seconds. Michael Bernberg is closely following Peter in the Chrysler Viper in his Ferrari 550. He has just above a second up to Peter. And then again, behind Michael Bernberg, we have Jan Molbech in this Saline S7R. Behind Jan in this Saline, we have our last second entry of Jan Brodsgaard. In a Ferrari identical to Michael Bernberg's, and the last spot of the grid and the race of GT1 and the race in total is right now Christian Johansen, surprisingly, but I don't think he managed to put in a qualification time, so we will probably see him ascend through the grid throughout the race. Bear in mind, Christian Johansen was actually our race winner 2 weeks ago on Estoril. So no doubt this guy is fast enough, and the car's fast enough because it's at pole position. So it's a matter of time before we see this guy going up through the ranks. As you can see, 10th position is the safety car, which I have by now parked, and the television car. So as I told you, our competitor in the Aston Martin golf-colored Aston Martin DBR9, Ben Jewell, he's not with us anymore. He crashed out during the server restart. So, as an effect of that, one less contestant, in the GT1 category. So, just to sum that up, after the qualification and the technical problems and the race restart, we have now in this race 9 cars competing, 3 in LMP1 and 6 in GT1. And an update regarding our DNF, our exit of Ben Jewell in the Aston Martin. He's just written to me that he had some problems with his internet in the warm-up round or the safety car lap, which meant that he had some lag. Then he rammed into Peter Monkholm in the Chrysler Viper. And then he fell off again. So, internet problems is internet problems was the death of Ben Jewell. So, unfortunately, he's not going to be driving with us this evening. Watching now, Lars Granberg in second place in LMP1. Let's just get an updated time on this. He is 16.7 seconds behind Henrik Hoyer already. And Nicolai Pedersen on third place. He is 9.5 seconds behind Lars Granberg in the Audi. So, something has happened to Nicolai Pedersen, small spin or a small slide, and he has lost a couple of seconds. To be honest, the picture in LMP1 right now, oh, somebody went off the track there, I think. Whatever it was, the guy was back on again. Anyways, what I was saying was, the picture, our picture in LMP1 class at the moment, to be fair with you, quite expected, to be honest. Henrik Hoyer, very fast and consistent race leader with a clear margin in lap times of almost 4 seconds per lap at the minute. He's a lot in front already, quarter of a minute actually. Then comes Lars Granberg. Lars Granberg and Nicolai Pedersen, we expect to see those pretty close together. But as you possibly remember last time, Nicolai Pedersen was running the Peugeot 908 on Nesteryl. He had a lot of troubles and he ended up, I think, actually finishing last, even though he was an LMP car. Also notice that he's changed to the Aston Martin LMP car, so a change of brand for him. Which probably means that he has lost his former points. If he did win any points in the last race at Estoril, and any points he has possibly made at the 24-hour race back in October, they will be disregarded now, and he will start from scratch in the Aston Martin. Change of car is not allowed during the season. That being said, I don't think Nicolai had that many points to Karras, so he's trying something new, and this seems to be working out for him, because he has this car under a lot more control, and he's going faster than Lars Granberg in the Audi at the moment. Catching up, actually, as it seems, as he has reduced the gap to 9.5 seconds now, and not 9.8 as it was earlier. Comment from a viewer, one of our guys in DGCL. He's not racing tonight, but a guy called Martin Eldell. He's commenting that the curves in the chicane we are using that a lot. As you can see here, Lars Granberg is cutting the curves very much. He's also going to do it here. Yes, Martin. GTR 2 in this version of the track is very polite with the judgment it gives for cutting the track. Cutting the track, a cut track warning. You will need three of those to get a stop and go punishment. And a few places you will get a stop and go directly. I think if you go straight in the first chicane instead of taking the chicane, you will receive a stop and go directly. But also, as you will see here with Lars, he's cutting the curb a lot here, and the curbs are indeed quite low in the GTR2 version, and that means that a lot of time can be made cutting the very hard. Might not be as realistic as it can get, but then on the other hand, the terms are equal for everybody, and especially in this chicane here, Variante della Rocchia, you can see the drivers are cutting the track, cutting the curbs a lot. I have to agree with you, Martin. The curbs are probably harder and higher in real life. And they wouldn't be able to cut it that much in real life. But on the other hand, even though it's not very realistic, it's equal for everybody. So it's a matter of setting your car up correctly for it to be able to do that, because it's actually not that easy. You need to have a very stable car, and the suspension units have to be set up quite nicely for you to be able to take the curves as hard as we see Lars doing at the moment, without the car getting unsettled or dangerous to drive. The gap from Henrik Høyer down to Lars Granberg is now half a minute already. But then again, the gap from Lars to Nikolai, that's what we were talking about earlier, that is the last time they crossed the finish line, 6.7 seconds. So the gap here has decreased by 3 seconds. And as I said earlier, that's honestly what I expected. Henrik Høyer is clear favorite to win the race. But Lars Granberg and Nikolaj Pedersen, who has obviously done something new with his car and his setup, which has rendered him running much better than he was 2 weeks ago. The race between number 2 and number 3 in LMP1 is actually quite close and can be interesting in the long run. On first position in GT1, there's been a change. First runner is Peter Munkholm. He is running the Chrysler Viper Saline. Sorry, Chrysler Viper GTSR. Rubbish. On Michelin tyres. From him down to Kasper Holgaard in the Lamborghini, there's 5.5 seconds. And then from the Lamborghini down to Alan Saline. There the Saline comes. That's 3.7 seconds, and then from the Saline down to Michael Bloomberg and this Ferrari, that's 2.6 seconds. So top four in GT1, very close. Then from position 4 down to position 5, Jan Brodsgaard, the teammate of Michael Bloomberg, as you can see, two similar Ferraris. That's 8 seconds from 4th to 5th place. And then finally, Christian Johansen, clearly some kind of trouble for him. As you can see, he's over half a lap behind, and he's 54.9 seconds behind behind Jan Brøsgaard in the Ferrari 550. Jan Brøsgaard in the Ferrari 550, as mentioned, joined in the very last minute of qualifying, and did make it. So he's racing, and he's not racing last. So he missed not being able to start by the blink of an eye. Chris Dunshandon here, having a hard time. His last lap time was 1:47, which is, to be honest, way too slow. He did that again almost. That was a 1:46 something. That was a 1:46.7. To be honest, not at all fast enough. But without me knowing anything, it could be what I mentioned during qualifying. Given that Monza, it's a track with a lot of straights. That means you are spending a lot of time riding the car with the wide open throttle. Also meaning that you're spending a lot of fuel during this race. And what might be happening is that the Chris is slowed right down right now to save some fuel. And possibly that either he's just running slowly, or possibly it might be strategy from his side, because if he saves some fuel now, he won't have to do that for the remaining part of the race. And that's and if it renders him able to do the race on a single pit stop, that might be the difference between winning and losing. So two options for our last runner, Chris Dunshandon, right now. Either he's just going incredibly slow, or he's being sneaky. My guess would be sneaky, because this guy is quick enough. Henrik Hoyer, still in first place. He's just overtaken these GT cars with a lap. So already there's over 1 minute and 30 seconds difference between the first LMP cars and the front runners of GT1. So as you can tell, a big speed difference between the classes. Some of you out there might also be thinking, why the hell are they running two classes with only 9 drivers? Well, thing is, we have been running one class for many years, and even though you have 15 to 20 cars on track, at some point in the race everything settles down and you will be racing around on the track all alone anyway, despite the fact that there's a lot of cars on the track. With introducing the LMP class and evening out the GT1 class, the GT1 cars are not the standard cars from GTR2. The physics have been remade and modified. In a way that means that every single car should have a possibility of winning. Because they have been equaled out on speed or economy, meaning that one car might be able to go a lot faster. For example, the Maserati MC12, which is not being run today, unfortunately. It's a cool car, I like it. But the Maserati MC12 is very, very fast, but it does also use almost half a liter more per lap than the rest of the cars do, which means that even though it's a lot faster, it would have to make two full pit stops on this track to make the 2 hours. And the catch there being that it will have to be a lot faster than, for example, Peter in this Chrysler Viper here to actually be able to win the race overall. Because in the Chrysler Viper, Peter should be able to make he will very possibly be able to make a single pit stop to complete 2 hours of racing. So that's the way the cars have been balanced out, and theoretically speaking, at least on the Le Mans circuit, the evening out has been done with regards to the Le Mans circuit we're running at the 24-hour race. But it should turn out more or less equal also on other tracks, and so that's the way that's been done. And theoretically speaking. Every single car should be able to win. First place GT1, Peter Munkholm. At the last passing of the start and finish rate, he was 4.6 seconds ahead of position 2, which is right now Kasper Holgaard in the red Lamborghini. And as you can see, clearly the Lamborghini is able to go fast enough. So, Christian Jansen in the other Lamborghini going slow. I've just confirmed my theory of he might slowing a bit down to save fuel. Maybe Kasper and Chris in the two Lamborghinis might even have chosen different strategies. And then, which Lamborghini will be the fastest? That will be an interesting battle. So, from second to first position in GT1, 4 seconds flat from according to the last lap time. Kasper Holgaard in this Lamborghini running quite a bit faster than Peter in the Chrysler Viper, and you can actually see Kasper in the background here as Peter is turning into this chicane. The chicane called Variante della Rocchia. So, first position, second position, in third position, Michael Bernberg. He has advanced past Jan Molberg and Celine. There's 5.1 seconds from second to third place. And then from third to fourth place, Jan Molberg. And he is just above 2 seconds behind the Ferrari. We have Jan Bodskov, which I don't have time for, just a moment. Jan Bodskov 17 seconds behind, and doing that is not going to help his time. Let's just see if he's able to get out of the sand trap. Oh, it looks like he might have stalled the engine. Yeah, there he goes, lumping out of the sand trap. Yep, Jan Bodskov on his way, but that cost him at least 10 seconds there. So another 10 seconds on his already big gap of 17 seconds up to Jan Molberg at the Saline. And then, and Jan Bodskov making yet another error. That's a shame for him. He's enough behind already. Christian Jansen, last position in GT1. From Christian's up to Jan Bodskov. It's in the region of 40 or 50 seconds at the moment after Jan Bodskov's errors in, after Jan in the Ferrari, after he made his errors. That's a margin of, probably around 45 seconds. From last position. Oh, and Christon's, as we were talking about earlier, the curbs being very treacherous, and Chris hitting the curb too hard here and spending a lot of time doing that, And as you could probably just see, he actually was overtaken by Peter Munkholm and Kasper Holgaard here, which means he's a lap down now. If this is pit tactics or just poor running, he certainly is a lot off. Something's wrong with that car, I think. Because that's not turning properly. Whether or not it's tactics on... Oh, very close to cutting Jan Mulberg and Selina off also. This is interesting. Whether or not it's tactics or just poor running, as I said. He has a lot of time to catch up now. Almost 2 minutes. Up to first position in GT1, and that's a lot of time, to be honest. Even with some pit stops messing up or something, that's still unlikely to happen. But Chris Dons haven't bought the farm yet, so everything can happen. Off the race, we still have another 1 hour and 29 minutes remaining, so only 1/4 of the race has been run. Lars Granberg here. He is 9.1 seconds behind Nikolaj Pedersen. Nikolaj Pedersen, as we were just seeing before, he's at least a minute behind first position Henrik Højer in the Epsilon Oscar D car. You can see Henrik Højer in the Epsilon, he's coming down to the second chicane, the Variante della Rocchia. And second position in LMP, Nikolaj Pedersen, he's coming down to the Parabolica. So he hasn't even entered lap 19 yet. Let's just see if we get a split time on Nikolaj up to Henrik on first position. He's going to pass the finish line in just a moment. Oh, in a time of 1:40, that's slow for an LMP car, to be honest. And that leaves him with a gap of... Yes. The gap between first and second position hasn't really appeared in the timing. But the gap between second and third position, Nikolaj Pedersen and Lars Granberg, that is getting smaller. Last lap it was 9 seconds something, this lap it's 8 seconds point one. So, Lars Granberg is catching up now, partly because Nikolaj Pedersen in the Aston Martin DBR 1-2 has slowed down a lot, actually. His last lap time was 1 minute 40 and a half. 1 minute 40 seconds and a half a second. Whereas Lars Granberg in the Audi, he did a 1 minute 39 seconds and 5 tenths. So Lars Granberg here, over a second quicker last lap. And at this rate, he's going to catch up in 7 or 8 laps. On first position in GC1, Peter Monkholm, still his last lap time was 1:44.2. Not very quick, to be honest, but still not too shabby, and it, at time being, will keep him his first position. Kasper Hougaard on second place. He's 4 seconds behind, and behind him, 1.8 seconds behind, is Michael Bernberg in the Ferrari. But Michael Bernberg going a bit quicker last lap than Kasper in the Lamborghini, but not this lap, I can see. So Michael and Kasper seem to be quite equal. And it seems we have our first pit stop. That would be Peter Monkholm with the Chrysler Viper. Missed his pit stand there, by a couple of centimeters. He's refueling now. It will be interesting to see whether or not he will take new tires as well. He probably will. I don't think he will be able to double stint the tires on this track. Even though there's not a lot of corners, the high speeds on the straights still put a lot of strain on the tires. And indeed, as you can see, the car has been lifted up now and the tires are being changed. Jan Brødsgaard in the Ferrari, not pitting in, so he's now in first position. Peter Monkholm on the ground now, almost stalling the engine, but he gets away anyway. Pits out on second position, not too bad, and he wasn't a lot behind first position, actually. So Peter Monkholm now in second position after his pit stop. First position, Jan Brødsgaard in the Ferrari. Running quite well at the moment, and also quite quickly. But he hasn't pit in. He hasn't pitted in yet. So he will lose his first place, and that will be soon. Peter Montgomery, you can see in the Viper, not that far behind actually. We're talking under 10 seconds, I think. Hen-
Henrik Højer still in first position.
Nikolaj Pedersen, second position now.
Lars Grønberg and Audi haven't been able to catch him yet. Lars must have made some kind of error,
because the gap between those two has extended to 10 seconds between third position here and second position here.
In the lead now in GG1, Kasper Holger. He has just overtaken Michael Bernberg. These guys haven't pitted in yet. And what I was telling you before was actually wrong. Because Kasper Holger running first and Michael Bernberg running second at the moment. Jan Molbech is running third, and Jan Borskov and Peter Munkholm are actually running fourth and fifth right now. But the difference being that Peter has pitted in contrary to the front runners. And, I'm just trying to figure out how much time is left. It's 1 hour and 19 minutes left, and as Peter has just made his first pit stop, that is telling me he's going to make a two-stopper, another one-stop, probably, because his tires are not able to stay the distance. But with 1 hour and 19 minutes remaining, he will have to do a single other pit stop. So, as we were talking about doing qualifying, at least the WAPA not able to do a single stop strategy this time, because Monza being so heavy on the fuel economy. Picture right now is the fight for first position in GG1. The distance between these two guys isn't very big at the moment. The distance between first and second position in GG1 right now is under half a second. But my guess is that neither of these guys have been in the pit. And to be honest, my conclusion is they haven't been in pits yet. That's what we can see off the numbers. So this fight for first position, regardless of who will win it, it won't stay this way, because they will have to pit in some point in 10 or 15 minutes time. At the latest. In the meantime, I can hear that Henrik Højer has been in the pit lane. This means that he is now down to third position in LMP1. More cars coming onto the pit lane. That is Michael Bernberg in the Ferrari 550. So he has let go of his grip of first position in GT1, Kasper Højgaard. still, Gaspar hasn't entered the pits. Not a surprise there, the Ferrari 550 should probably be more petrol hungry on this track. Jan Molbeck hasn't been in either, running second in GT1, spinning off here actually in Variante Ascari. I think it is. No, that's Variante della Roccia. He's going through the Lesmo corners now. But Jan Molbeck, as I was saying, hasn't been in yet in the pit lane either, so we will see number one and number two in GT1 pit in a couple of minutes. Jan Boilsgaard hasn't been in either still. Peter Montgomery chasing him down. More people entering the pit. Michael Bernberg still in the pit lane. That's one guy more in here I can hear. Michael leaving the pit lane now. Oh, that's the engine sound I could hear. Michael has left the pit lane now. 8th position. So that is the last position GT1 he's in right now because of his pit stop. Christian Johansen, I should probably just say, whom we saw run very slowly earlier in the other red Lamborghini. He's not running anymore. He had to quit with some technical difficulties as well. But in this regard, I'm not sure it was his computer's fault. I think something went wrong with his driving. Jan Boilsgaard is entering the pits now. He's going into his pit stop here. That's his first trip down pit lane. Peter Montgomery, it seems his early pit stop is paying off now. He's advancing through the ranks, he's in third position right now. Second position of Jan Molbeck. Seems they're overtaking LMP cars as well now. That means he is first. Nah, here goes race leader. The red Ferrari, sorry, the red Lamborghini in the picture, that's race leader in GT1, Kasper Højgaard. He's in pit lane now, which means he's been overtaken by Jan Molbeck. So Jan Molbeck in the Saline, he's running first now. But Jan, I don't think has been in the pit lane yet. So we're expecting to see Jan in the Saline come into the pit lane still and see the positions in GT1 swap yet another time. Also in picture is third position of Nikolaj Pedersen. Kasper Højgaard leaving the pit now. Third position of Nikolaj Pedersen in the Aston Martin LMP car, also in the pit lane. Seems to be taking a long time for Nikolaj Pedersen here. And here Nikolai Pedersen goes. He's leaving the pit now. Big enough margin down to the GT1 cars as not rendering him being overtaken. But it does mean that he has some catching up to do to Lars Grönberg, whom is in the pit now. So if Nikolai Pedersen's stop was quick enough and he is able to get around the circuit quick enough, he will be able to overtake Lars while he is still in the pit lane. We will have to watch that. And as predicted, Jan Molbech is pitting in now as well. So he will have to let go of first position in just a moment. I can hear a Ferrari closing in. Also, Peter Moncalmier is coming down the pit straight in just a moment. Going through the parabolic corner. Passing the pit entry. And there he goes. That is now Peter Moncalm in the lead, and it would seem at the time being that Peter Moncalm's very early pit stop after just 40 minutes of running has paid off. Peter is now in the lead, and by the looks of things, with an acceptable margin down to Kasper Højgaard, former race leader, on second position. Jan Molbech in the Saline is now leaving the pit lane again. He's coming out on third position, and he's able to keep that second position in MP1. Lars Grönberg, he's also left the pits. Nikolai Pedersen not being able to catch him, so there's a regular margin between these two now. Let's just see what happens when he passes the finish straight. Yep, there's 15 and a half seconds between third and second position in an MP1, so 15 and a half seconds between Nikolai Pedersen here and Lars Grönberg here, going into Valiant della Roggia. But then again, from second position all the way up to first position, we are seeing over a lap of gap. Henrik Højer is a lap in front of his fellow competitors in LMP1. And as you can see, he just passed through the first chicane by the name of Vallante del Rettifiglio. Which means that Henrik Højer is now going down to the second corner and Lars Grönberg in the Audi. As we can tell, he is now going down to the Parabolica, so that means there's only around half a lap between those guys. Which again means that Henrik Højer in the Epsilon is just around 1.5 lap in front. And at the look of things, Henrik Højer is going very quickly right now. And that will soon render Lars Grönberg another lap behind. Oh, just switching camera views in time to see Nikolai Pedersen here hitting the AMCO at the inside of the last turn, the Parabolica. That car is pretty beat up, as you can tell. Still, Nikolai opting not to enter the pit lane. Interesting decision. On a track as fast as Monza. I might have done the opposite of what he did, because the aerodynamics are pretty important. And being that he crashed in the last corner, it was a pretty obvious to hit the pit lane. Still, going that slowly, he has still yet to know how badly damage affects his top speed. And if it isn't that bad, actually, he might be better off just running along with it. But a slight bump for Nikolai Pedersen here means the time between third and second position has increased now to 28 seconds. So 28 seconds from Nikolai all the way up to Lars Grönberg here. Thank you. let's just have a look at the standing in GT1 now, after the pit stops have settled everything down. In first position, Peter Munkholm now benefiting from his early pit stop. Whether or not that will keep him golden all the way to the end of the race, only time will tell. But most likely, all of the cars left have another pit stop to do.